Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Hitherto hath the Lord helped Ian and myself. We've come to the conclusion of our series on premarital counseling. It's been nothing else but the grace of God that brought us thus far. Ebenezer, amen. Praise his wonderful name. Closing video teaching this morning is raising a Christian family. Amen. I trust that as we have shared what God has laid upon my heart throughout the years of my ministry is a blessing to you. Like I said earlier on, I'm not an expert on marriage. I've made my mistakes. I failed. But thank God, He gave me a godly woman that's been my companion, that has stood alongside of me, who undergirded me with her fortitude and her strength and her wisdom and her counsel. You know, she has been, no doubt, my strength. Other than the Lord, she's the closest person to me. Amen. I love her dearly, and sometimes I don't give her due respect, but maybe one of these days, Ian and I have to twist her arm. I'll have to tie her up, and Ian has to help me drag her here for her to preach God's word to you. Amen. She's a very shy lady, but a very loving lady. And Ian just loves her cooking. Amen. And we had such a lovely time. Sunday we went out for lunch as a family, and it was just good enjoying Father's Day together. Amen. Now, let's go to the Word of God. And we're talking on raising a family. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6. And by the way, I'm not going in depth. I'm just laying a premise. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Raising a family is not only responsible, it is very demanding. But before I go to the demands and the responsibilities, one of the greatest blessings that God has given mankind is the blessing of reproduction. And many people fail to understand the purpose of reproduction. And if you live out the purpose of reproduction, you'll have a lovely family life. You know, what God has done, He has also empowered us to do likewise. God created man in His own image and likeness. I think when we read the book of Genesis, we get the understanding of the power of God. He spoke by fiat decree, and the heavens and the earth came about. Although Job speaks of God fashioning the heavens and the earth, yet He spoke. And how He fashioned it surely is a mystery to you and I. But the crowning creation of God was mankind. After He created the heavens and the earth, He says it is good. But after that He had created man, He said it is very good. Man was but nothing less than the image and likeness of God. And the purpose why God had created man was for nothing else than fellowship, to commune with man, to communicate, to be one with man. The Bible says, in the cool of the day, God came down into the garden to communicate and have fellowship with Adam and Eve. Now, God gave you and I the self-same blessing. Just as God created after His own kind, and that man in his image and likeness, so has God blessed with you and I the ability to reproduce after our own kind. That just as God was, as if God was looking in a mirror when he saw Adam and Eve, when you and I reproduce after our own kind and we look at our children, often it is as if we are looking into a mirror, for what we see is nothing else but a reflection of ourselves. What an honor. What a blessing. And the very purpose of God creating Adam and Eve was for fellowship, for communion, that they'll spend time together and enjoy each other's company. Oh, hallelujah. And the purpose why we have a family is that we have fellowship. We enjoy each other's company. We draw strength from each other. Amen. We enjoy each other. Hallelujah, because we're having fellowship with our own kind. Isn't that wonderful? Marvelous, marvelous. Now, as much as there is that ultimate blessing, there always comes responsibility. And raising a family in this modern day world is a very difficult task. But let me say this, the grace of God is sufficient. Now, sad to say, many parents fail in raising their children as God's people. You know, if you start wrong, it's difficult. And I feel that we have to have an understanding of just where we start. The Bible says, train up a child. Amen. Now, I believe, I'm not an expert, like I said, but I believe that there's life in the womb. Amen. I believe as the seed comes together, life is imparted. Amen. And I believe that as much as that child is growing in the womb of the mother, there is life there. That child in the womb is alive. Amen. And the best place to begin in raising a child and training a child is when the child is still in the womb. You know, music is powerful. Words are powerful. I don't fully understand all what takes place. I don't know the ramifications, but some or the other, I'm of the persuasion that that child, some or the other, makes contact, or we make contact. And we should sing to our children, speak to our children. You know, it's a wonderful thing. You know, when the baby starts to move and starts to kick, and how that the wife will say, look, feel it, put your hand in, he's kicking, and you lay your hand, boom, there he kicks, and you see the movement. Oh, what a wonderful feeling. Hey, that's a time to talk to him. Or to talk to her. That's a time to sing a song. Amen. And once they're born, amen. Understand this. You know, the biggest problem that God has with you is the same problem that he has with me. It's the same problem that we have with our children. Jesus said, let this mind be in you. You know, when your mind and my mind is fused with the mind of God, there's always victory in our life. When our mind is outside of God's mind, when our actions are outside of the Word of God, which no doubt are embedded through our mind, then we have problems. So our duty in raising our children, first and foremost, what are your aims? What are your goals with this child? You got to aim. You got to shoot your arrow. What are you aiming for in raising your child? What's your purpose? You don't just meander, do this, that, and the other. You have a purpose. You know what you're aiming at. And this is the aim. You know, children have a mind of their own. Children have a mind of their own. And I've got 4 grandchildren, the 2 big boys are big now, and praise God, they're wonderful boys, they're serving the Lord. But now we've got 2 little granddaughters, Michelle and Kate, and one is almost 5 and one is almost 3, and they're lovely children. But you know, the little problems that we are having with them is the self-same problem that God is having with us. And that is, we have a mind of our own. We have a will of our own. And listen to me, the work of the Spirit of God is to place within you and me the mind of God, that we might do the things of God. And your work as a father and as a mother is to instill in the child from a very early age the mind of God. That if that child thinks godly, that child will begin to act godly from a very early age. And I find, and please, I'm not now bashing, but you go into homes and you look at many Christian homes, we should hang our head in shame. I grew up in an environment in Cape Town, the most beautiful city in the world. And by the way, they have the most beautiful ladies as well, because my wife is a Cape Townian. Oh boy, when I met her, it was love at first sight. When she met me, it was love at first fright, but never mind. But I grew up where there was much diversity in religion. But there was one religion which I don't want to mention. But whenever you went into the homes of these people that adhered to this religion, it was unique. There were always photographs of their scriptures in their lounge, in their kitchen, everywhere except the toilet. They wouldn't have anything there. But there was always the scriptures. Always the scriptures. You go in our Christian homes, and I tell you, it's almost a miracle if you find the scriptures displayed. I have one in my home, yes, and Ian's going to point it out. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But this is only one scripture in my entire home. And I feel that what we've got to realize is this, that if we are going to instill into our children as they grow, especially when they are young, then we have to move within them in such a way that we begin to impart to their senses, their eye gate, their ear gate, their touch gate, their smell gate. They've got to see God's word. They've got to hear God's word. Amen. I remember my lecturer, Dr. Don B. Coleman. He told us a remarkable story. He said he would walk past his little boy's room every day going to work. And what he would do, he would whistle. And I can't whistle because my false teeth. But he would whistle. And he would whistle for some time. And then after 6 months, one day, he got a shock of his life. As he whistled and walked away, the little boy began whistling. It wasn't a perfect whistle, but it was a whistle. That child heard, and the child mimicked. And I think what we've got to do is this. As small as they are, play Christian music in their rooms. Play the scriptures over and over. Let the scriptures soak into their spirits at a very, very early age. Begin to implant the mind of God. You know, someone said, give me a child and I will teach him the ways of my religion from birth to the age of 7, and they will never depart from that religion. You know, that is true. And what I feel we need to do as Christians, we need to make every concerted, concentrated effort, especially when our children are young, to soak them with the Word of God. Instill within them the mind of God. Someone also said that habits are formed when children are very young. And the more they hear of the word, the more Christian habits are they going to follow and adopt. You see, outside of the word of God, if the children do not hear the word, do not see the word, then they're going to form habits which are outside of the word of God. But if they hear the word and see the word, then you know what? They're going to form habits which are based upon the word of God. And it's hard to break a habit. And I'll never forget Linda Maud Finn that had this wonderful saying, habit. H-A-B-I-T. Take away the H, you still live with a bit of the habit. Take away the H and the A, you still live with a bit of the habit. Take away the H, the A and the B, and you still live left with each of the habit. It's hard to break a habit. And what we're saying is this, as our children hear the word of God, as they see the word, as they grow from an early age, they formulate Christian habits, which is good for their lifestyle. Don't do that, and they will form other habits, which will not be good for a lifestyle. So we have, from a very early age, to indoctrinate our children. Amen. The Bible says, as we turn there, let's go there to Ephesians chapter 6, am I right? Yes, Ephesians chapter 6. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. And your fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Now, bless the Lord. Like I said, the problem that God has with us is we've got our own mind. Through the word and the work of the Spirit of God and the men of God, God is imparting his mind. And as we embrace the mind of God, our lifestyle changes, our mindset changes, and we live out according to that which is in our mind, godly action. Now the same applies with our children. And what we have to teach them is nothing less than the mind of God. And we have to show them the rewards as such of heeding the word of God. We have to teach our children to obey us as parents. We need to teach them to obey us. Now, it's just not teaching obedience. You've got to explain what is the evidence of obedience. You know, in my family, I'm sure many people look and get surprised. There's almost not a day that go past that my family will not mention to each other and to me, even though half the time I always anger my my kids get angry at me. But we always say to each other, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. Even when they phone, they put the phone in, love you, darling, bang, goes down. When we leave the house, our kids say to us, our grandkids, do come another day, love you, Pa, love you, Ma. But we always saying that to each other. But you know, we've got to teach them what is the evidence of love. And from a very small age, teach them that obedience is the evidence of love. If you say you love mommy and daddy, then you must listen to mommy and daddy. Amen? Obedience is evidence of love. And then you've got to reward your children. Amen? For being obedient. There are intrinsic rewards and extrinsic rewards. But children usually respond to extrinsic motivation. So instill in your children obedience of honoring you. Amen. Now, you got to also, when raising your children from a very early age, set the environment, set the scene as such. Amen. Now, I know of some men of God. Oh, they're the mighty men of God. When they speak, it thunders. Oh, the earth quakes. When they come home from work or even from their ministry, they would come and say, no, darling, I won't eat now. No, 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 no. after you spend time with the Lord first. And what they did, they go in their bedroom and close the door. If that's the way God has dealt with you, you go ahead. But I always felt in my heart that when I communicate with my God, when I worship my Lord, when I stand or prostrate myself before Him, my door, my bedroom is always open. I want my kids to walk past and see Dad is worshiping the Lord. I want them not only to see, I want them to hear, and I want them to come in and join with me. Set the pattern, set the pace, set the example. Don't ever close your prayer door closet. Leave it open. Let them come in and join with you, stand with you, prostrate themselves as you prostrate themselves. I'll never forget this. Never ever. But my children were baptized in the Spirit of God. They were about 8 and 6 and 5 years old, each one of them. And they spoke fluently in tongues. Out of the mouths of babes and sucklings has the Lord God ordained strength. We, my wife and I, created an environment for them. They never sat at the meal table without us praying and thanking God. At most times we open the Word. And if we never open the Word at the meal table, I tell you, we had devotions with them. We ministered God's Word. And as they grew, as young as they were, I had my friend make me a special pulpit. I would stand behind it, the wife would stand behind it, and then we make the kids stand behind it. We make them stand on the chair, and we let them preach to us. If they couldn't preach, they would quote the Scriptures. But they grew up in the environment that our home was a godly, godly home. Amen. And then also, you know, it's just not starting at a very, very young age, making your children God conscious. But you know, I haven't got time to go deep, but if you read the Old Testament, that the woman took their children out and taught them line upon line, precept upon precept, the Word of God. They had phylacteries that were on their wrists and on their head. It was Scripture inscribed. And even as they went out doing their little duties, their little children, helping mom perhaps, whenever they had a free moment, they had to memorize what was on the phylactery. You got to teach your children to memorize God's Word. You know, it's in moments of trouble and affliction that you know not what to do. But suddenly, a word will come from God. And that word that comes from God is a word that you had deposited in your life, into your spirit, when you memorize the Scripture. And what you're doing when you teach your children how to memorize Scripture, you are placing within them a bedrock of treasure of the Word of God, that as they face life and as the calamities of life come their way, as they grow up, there's a power that comes from them that is able to withstand the calamities of life. Oh, instill the mind of God, which is found through the Word of God. Teach your children to honor you, to respect you. Amen. Tell them that there's long life from those who honor and respect their mothers and fathers. I say it with all my heart, and you say amen, Ian. I love my mother and my father. I love them.
Amen. I love my mom and dad too.
Amen. And I believe I'm going to live to a ripe old age because I honored them. Amen. And I've done it but by the grace of God. Then, the Bible also says, whom the Lord loves, the Lord chastises. We are living in a time where the world is changing. And in most countries these days, we're not allowed to slap our kids, chastise our kids. We in no way are to take a belt to them. In no way are to spank them. But what we do, what do we do? What do we do as Christians? When our kids start to go the wrong way. Well, I've noticed in many a home, they refrain from discipline of the hand, of the belt. They have a naughty corner. The children go in a naughty corner. And there they stand, and they realize they've done something wrong. Now, I do say that we got to respect the laws of our land. But at the same time, there comes a time that the child needs a little spanking. And the Bible says, whom the Lord loves, the Lord chastises. And we ought to, at times, give them a little tappy on the hand, a little tappy on the bum, not hard, but let them know from an early age, what you're doing is not right. Sit them down.
Doesn't the Bible say, train a child in the way they should go, and when they are old, they shall not depart from it?
That's true, that's true. I love the naughty corner, but I don't think the naughty corner is good enough. There is that little spanking as such. Now, it's good. And what I feel is also very vital in the raising of our children is the family meal. Is the family meal. You go to homes today, modern homes, the son is that side, the daughter's that side, the father's that side watching TV, the mother's in the kitchen all by herself, they all can't afford a laptop, but they're all having laptop suppers. That meal table is vital. And let me say this, fathers and mothers, that table is a place of joy, of fellowship. It's not a place when dad comes home from work that you complain about the kids in front of the kids. No, you place a rebellion in your heart, in the hearts of your children, not wanting to come to the table because all what they're going to get at the table is nothing else but scolding. My wife never ever done that. It was part of our raising of our children. If ever we had to deal with the children, we had a good time at the meal table, we laughed and we joked, and after we ate and had our devotions, then we spoke about their naughtiness. Amen? So, then also, don't send your children to Sunday school. Go with them to Sunday school. I don't know how it is in most countries, but there where I was born again, and that is in South Africa, I got saved in Open Door Assemblies, Havelock Road, Kenwood Park, South Africa, Durban. We had Sunday school for everyone, from the babes to the adults. And we used to go to the adult class, and the kids used to go to the baby class. And you know, it's surprising, you know, my children, and I thank God for this, my wife, were the best behaved children during church times. We used to notice how the other children used to run up and down, and people said, "Lord, but that's my little boy." Wasn't it time for showing off and being naughty? The first time my children left the side of their mother and ran down the aisle, they were taken outside, and my wife had a little stick known as Uncle Felix. Bang, bang. You know what? They never ran up and down. They sat beside mommy, or they sat on the floor next to mommy, and they sat quietly. Amen. My wife says something that I just love. You know, if it wasn't for her, in many a way, we would have gone wrong. But she always said this to me, Joe, or rather Joe boy, we don't just train our children for this home. We train them for the world. Amen. So in other words, you treat them manners, that they act mannerly outside of the home as well. Amen? You train them that they might be accepted in the community. And if they are naughty, disrespectful in the community won't accept them. So we need to raise our children in the ways of God. Whom the Lord loves, the Lord chastises. You know, one of the major problems that I find in the church is the lack of finance in the church. The lack of finance. And it is important that we teach our children to bless the work of God. Our kids went to Sunday school and they never went out an offering for the Sunday school. We gave them and we said, make sure you give the money, make sure you bless God's work. And they grew up this way, giving to the work of the Lord. Your home must be surrounded by love. Train your children in the ways of God. And you know, as a father, I've made many mistakes. My kids have seen me blow my top. My kids have heard me shout and scream. My kids have heard me argue. But just as much as they saw one side of me, the naughty side, at times the bad side, they also saw a good side. Whenever I messed up in front of my children, I made doubly sure that when I made right with my wife, if I offended my wife in their company, I made sure that they're there in my company when I ask my wife to please forgive me. And I'll say to my wife, I was wrong. I'm sorry, darling. I should not have said that. I should not have done that. My kids saw that whenever I was wrong, I made right and sought forgiveness. Amen. Then the other thing, the one thing that we love is that we always sat around the table. We played games together. We played fiddlesticks and whatnot. All these things we played, snakes and ladders. We had a good time with our children. We became the friends of our children. You know, when they grew up and they brought their boyfriends home, they danced so with delight because they knew when they come to mom and dad that their friends will be more than welcome because they knew of the atmosphere that God had created in that home. You know, when we played these games and all this type of thing, we fostered a relationship, not only of mother and father, but of friendship. And it's important that your children become your friends. You know, this is unique. My children cannot do without their mother. Oh, they can do without dad, you know, but they can't do without mom. My one daughter that lives in South Africa, my wife and I speak almost every day for an hour on the phone. My wife has to see the two daughters that are here in New Zealand at least 3 or 4 times a week. They cannot do without each other. They have a relationship, not only of family, but of friendship. They confide in each other. They share. Amen. And the other thing we taught them, they never ever heard us bad mouth people. They never heard us gossip. They never ever heard us run the church down. They never ever heard us speak of black and white, colored and pink. They never ever heard us swear in the house. I've never ever heard my children use profanity when they were children. Because if they ever done, their mother dealt with it. But I never heard them. They were raised in a family that loved God and were loved by God. Train your children in the ways of God. Let your children be encouragers, never running people down, always extending a hand. And if I boast, I'm boasting of the Lord. My children, as young as they were about 7 or 8 years old. They were witnessing to adults. They used to pray for adults. They led 1 or 2 adults to the Lord, as young as they were. The one thing I must admit, and I'm sorry for what I had done, I was so busy with the work of the Lord that I was never home. And the responsibility of raising my family was on the shoulders of my wife. But she done an excellent job. Amen. But thank God, God's hand has been upon my family. So I encourage you, raise your children in the way of God. Don't be slow to discipline your children. Don't be slow to reward your children. Amen. Become their friend. Sit around the table, share God's word, play with them, spend time with them. And remember this one thing. Don't just raise your children for your home. Raise them for the church and for the world. Let them be of benefit to everyone. God bless you. And as we come to the close of the series, I want to thank Ian for his work. Amen. Thank God for his patience, listening to me and doing the video and putting it on the internet. And I trust that God will bless your family. Amen. That you will grow in the knowledge and the nurture of God's word. God bless you. God keep you. And may your family life be blessed of the Lord. Amen. And this whole series has been dedicated to my sister-in-law, Sandra Ward, who was a godly woman, a godly wife, and a godly mother. And though she's gone on to be with the Lord, her labor has not been in vain, because it will continue in the people that she had ministered unto, and even in the life of her children, and that being Tessa and Mark. We thank God that she stood alongside her husband, Pastor Peter Ward, all the years. Amen. And even now, as they come into the close of the building of their church building, that God will reward them with many, many, many souls added to that church. Once again, thank you for listening to us, and the Lord bless you. Amen.